Welcome back to Whence Came You, a Freemasonic podcast featuring research papers and discussions related to Freemasonry. I'm your host, Brother Robert Johnson. This is episode 211. This week, we've got some great things going on here in the show. I will be reading a short excerpt from a wonderful pamphlet slash book from Manly P. Hall. And then we have a conversation with Frater O relating to loosely to the excerpt that we're going to read, or at least it connects on the ideas that we're going to talk about on this episode. And we also have illustrious Brother Stephen L. Harrison coming on the program to deliver our Masonic Minute news. So in the news this week, we did release the Masonic Radio Theater's episode number 7, part 1. Of the Lodge of Gold. So the premise behind the Lodge of Gold is an interesting one. It's not 100% historically accurate, but in a nutshell, if you could imagine a Wild West adventure, and there is a Lodge of Gold, El Dorado Lodge number 79. Why number 79? Well, you science guys might figure that one out. Anyway, what is great about the story is we have three who all lived in the same era. It is conceivable that they all would have and could have met. Every character in this series, which should be about 4 parts, will have had an opportunity to have met in real life. And just to let you know, we're talking about Doc Holliday, we're talking about Wyatt Earp, Billy the Kid, Albert Pike, James Dolan, Johnny Ringo. All these guys lived and could have met. Hypothetically, we have woven those into an interesting amalgamation of an adventure tale, and this first part is only about 10-11 minutes, but it took us forever to put it together, mostly because I've just been so busy, and it took a while to get some of the actors or the voice talents parts in, but I believe that it was done very well. I think we accomplished what we wanted to accomplish with it, and I am already starting to put together part 2. So those parts were mailed out. I've already got all of Billy the Kid's lines for this next episode, so really looking forward to that. We did have a little bit of a mishap in that we had the credits underlying in the intro of the show. For whatever reason, I messed up the audio, so we had to bring it down for a day, and it went back out the other night. So it is available. It's out there. I hope you guys all enjoy it. Sit down and have a listen. It is usually a very family-friendly show. We do have, I believe, one use of the word damn in there. So if you do have kids and you are watching it, just to forewarn you. So outside of that, TMR, we had a great episode the other week. We unfortunately did not have Brother Jason Richards on. He was under the weather, and he's doing a lot better. So awesome. Glad he's feeling better. But if you didn't get a chance to listen to it, we talked about your elevator pitch and all about what to do when somebody asks you about masonry. You've only got 30 seconds, and are you going to be able to keep that fire lit? Or are you going to blow it out on accident? So it was a great episode. It was a lot of interesting information, and I think we all got a good takeaway from it. And I learned a lot from the brothers on the show, and as well as everybody who was interacting with us on Twitter and on Facebook. Just amazing, amazing things. And to your brother Scott Sherman, I said something on the show. I said gematria, and he told me there's no soft G's in the language, so gematria. I hope I said it right this time, Brother Scott. I always thank you for helping me understand the language a little bit better. So, without any further ado, we will get started with a brief reading from The Occult Anatomy of Man by Manly P. Hall. And this is published by the Philosophical Research Society, Incorporated, located at 3341 Griffith Park Boulevard, Los Angeles, California. So, briefly, I would like to read Part 3, or some excerpts from Part 3, called The Spinal Column. All right, and just to let you know that if you find this a little out of place, don't worry. You know, if some of this sounds a little familiar, I should say that I do believe we did read some excerpts from this book in a previous episode as well. I think I read part 1 of the introduction or a little bit of it. It is, chapters are a little lengthy for the podcast, so I will be briefly skimming some of these paragraphs, and then we will go into the conversation I had with Frater O about what we call the Templ of Man. And I will provide this full text as a PDF within the episode. So if this sounds interesting, if you want to read it, you will be full able to do that. And I hope you enjoy. So here we go. Part 3, The Spinal Column. Connecting the two worlds heaven above and the sphere of darkness below, is the spinal column, a chain of 33 segments protecting within them the spinal cord. This ladder of bones plays a very important part in the religious symbolism of the ancients. It is often referred to as a winding road or stairway. Sometimes it is called the serpent. At other times, the wand or scepter. The Hindus teach that there are three distinct canals or tubes in the spinal system. They call them Ida, Pingala, and Sushumna. These tubes connect the lower generative centers of the body with the brain. The Greeks symbolized them by the caduceus, the winged staff of Hermes. This consisted of a long rod, the central Sushumna, which ended in a knob or ball, the pons of the medulla oblongata. On each side of the knob are wings arched over, used to represent the two lobes of the cerebrum. Up this staff and twisted around it wind two serpents, one black, the other white. These represent the Ida and Pingala. The ancient Hindus have a legend concerning the goddess Kundalini, in which it is said that she descended by means of a ladder or cord from heaven to a little island floating in the great sea. Connecting this with embryology, it is evident that the ladder or cord represents the umbilical cord, which the little island is the solar plexus. When the ladder is cut away from heaven, the goddess flees in terror to a cave, a sacral plexus, where she hides far from the sight of men. Like Amaterasu, the Japanese goddess of the shining face, she must be lured from her cave. For while she is there and refuses to come forth, the world is in darkness. Kundalini is a Sanskrit word meaning a serpentine or twisting gas or force. This force, so the Eastern sages claim, can be drawn up through the central spinal canal, the Sushumna. When this essence strikes the brain, it pens the center of the spiritual consciousness and inner perception, bringing with it spiritual illumination. The system of culture whereby this is made possible is the most secret teaching of the Eastern saints, for they realize that this spiral twisting force is not only illuminating, but, like the serpent, which is its symbol, also a deadly poison. Smatterings of Eastern occultism are coming all the time into the Western world, but we are sorry to say that they are bringing with them endless suffering and sorrow. For these great truths in the hands of individuals incapable of rightly understanding or applying them destroy the intelligence and reason. Along the spine are a number of nerve ganglia and plexuses. All of these have their place in religious symbolism. For example, we are told that the early Jews called the sacral plexus and the sacrocecal ganglion the sites of Sodom and Gomorrah. This is a small plexus in the region of the kidneys called the sagittal plexus, which the ancients knew as the city of Tarsus, where St. Paul fought with the beasts. Higher occultism teaches that the lotus blossoms, nerve centers on the spine, are reflections or negative poles bearing witness of seven great positive centers of consciousness located in the brain. These seven functions through the centers on the spine in approximately the same way that the seven spirits before the throne function through the planetary bodies. The disciple is warned not to work with the centers upon the spine, but to labor instead with their true rulers, the centers in the brain. So that's just a little taste of that chapter. I know it's a little wild. We did skip a chapter. So if there were things in there that were just blowing your mind or you're like, what are you talking about? Please do pick up that PDF version. Again, we offer the app completely free now. So you have no excuse not to hop on there, download it, and grab that PDF for your own edification. It is a truly remarkable text, and it is not long. It's not some huge tome. Manly P. Hall was pretty well known for writing, you know, I'll put the word books in quotation marks or air quotes, because these are really extended pamphlets. At most, you know, we're talking 60 pages on some of his greatest works. You know, this isn't Secret Teachings of All Ages or anything, which is pretty thick. These are to the point, long essays. I would probably deem them an essay more than a book. Do pick them up. Do read them. I think you will find something of value within them. They are pretty awesome. So with that, let's go right into the conversation we had with Frater O on the Temple of Man. All right, guys, we're back with Frater O, and today we're talking about the Temple of Man. A few weeks back, I had a new Master Mason ask me about this just in Blue Lodge, and I was absolutely fascinated by the question because not a whole lot of people are into it or discover this. A lot of esoteric Masons have found this for sure. And it's actually something that Frater O and I talked about from the beginning in our conversations when we started really diving down the rabbit hole. So welcome back to the show, Frater O.
Thanks again for having me back.
Oh, absolutely. So what initially got your attention about this Temple of Man thing? Where were you when you made a correlation or you saw a diagram, or and what was your feeling on it?
So, you know, I got my first degree back in 2007 in California, and took it very seriously and took 5 years off to literally learn to subdue my passions and really work on my Ashlers. And when you start going down that road, you start doing the self-reflection, you start bettering yourself as a human being, or chipping away, you know, at the Ashlers, and you start getting into meditation. And I found myself meditating. I found myself seeing unique things in meditation and trying to get answers to these questions. And a lot of people, you know, when you start knocking on doors Masonically or even in the New Age movement, they'll point you in another direction. Or A or B, they just want your money, right? They just want you to, I got all the answers. Can we pay this fee? Sit down, and I'm going to just spout off a bunch of bullshit that I memorized from another book. Or I took a course and I'm certified, so I can answer these questions. And it seems like that wasn't helping me. And when I started finding these esoteric diagrams online, the occult anatomy diagrams we've talked extensively on that anyone can find, or these really complex chakra charts of Hinduism, or these really complex chakra charts of Buddhism, or even these acupuncture charts with meridian lines, it started to make a lot of sense. So that's for me, it took like 5 years after I became an apprentice. And then once I started the meditation and the internal work, asking these deeper philosophical questions, I found myself kind of drawn to these areas. So that's where I kind of found myself.
Yeah.
And then diving into the books we'll get into. But how about yourself? How did you find yourself into these diagrams or into this rabbit hole of a topic in Masonry?
My experience was, I would say, enlightening in retrospect, not enlightening, and completely horrifying in the current, when I actually discovered it. When I was 27, 28 years old, whatever it was at the time, just a few years back, and I was attempting to read the Zohar, and I had a companion book, which I was going back and forth with. And so I was dealing with a lot of internal thought processes, thinking about and trying to digest the material of this Zohar. Anybody who's read the Zohar or knows anything about it, you know, there's some, rabbinical standards that go along with it. And I don't know if that's the correct term, but you have to be at least 40 years old. You have to have a full stomach, meaning, you know, you have to have a family. You have to be well established in your life before you start doing this. Because to study the Zohar is quite taken as a super serious thing. It's not something that's just a fly by night. Hey, I'm just going to pick up the Zohar and read it. That's just not how it works. And that's how I tried to do it. And so whether it had an impact on me or not, or it had the impact of what later happened to me, I don't know. I basically had, I developed like super mega stress, and I had anxiety attacks and stuff. And we talked about that in the past. And as I started reading more and more about ways to get rid of the anxiety without having to take medication, I was really reading into chakras. And then all of a sudden, one day, there was the Tree of Life from the Kabbalah, or the Kabbalah, laid on to a man. And that's when I first realized, like, okay, there's got to be something going along with the body of a man and this Kabbalistic Tree of Life. And then you see that same tree, like, dropped onto a map of Solomon's Temple. And I said, what's going on here? And so that's kind of where I found out about it. And I said, you know, initially horrifying, because at the time I was in a hospital and having the shakes, thinking I was going to die. So that was my horrifying experience. But, you know, retrospect, completely enlightening.
Well, so that's amazing that you can open yourself up to the listeners and everyone so personal. You know, and there's many times that, you know, we go through these spiritual awakenings, these initiatic experiences, and there's unfortunately, there's very few people you can turn to that aren't really dead set on a system, you know, or if you get stuck in Western medicine, you immediately get stuck with a symptom, you know, and get labeled, mm-hmm. and then you start getting treated for the symptom, except for instead of going back to the root of the problem.
Right. Well, you know, it's constant root cause analysis that just doesn't work with the human body as it relates to, I guess, you know, the way physicians treat people today. You know, root cause analysis, Rob Lewis, another brother, gave a fantastic analogy one time on his radio show. And it was, if you are a plant manager at a factory and you're walking around and every day you see a little puddle of oil and you ask your guy, you say, hey, what's with that puddle of oil? And they say, oh, I'll look into it. And the guy looks into it. And the next week, the puddle's gone. And then the next week you walk by and the puddle's back. And you ask the guy, hey, that puddle's back. He goes, oh, yeah, you know, it's a faulty O-ring. I'll replace it again. So the guy goes back in and he replaces the faulty, leaky O-ring on this machine. And it's good for another week or so. Another week goes by, plant manager walks by, sees the puddle of oil again. Well, a root cause analysis would be a complete teardown of the machine, and they would find that perhaps the problem isn't the O-ring. What causes that O-ring to fail is another faulty part that was absolutely just mismanufactured or tightened too much. So, in that same respect, you know, doctors today are just throwing new O-rings at you, and they're not ever, you know what I mean? That's the pill. It's the O-ring. Here you go. Here you go. Here you go. Manage your symptoms. And then you said a while back, you know, I mean, there's no profit in curing you. It's all about just handing those dollar bills. Keep giving me that money for these pills, these co-payments. And I don't think every doctor's that way. I think that's the way medicine is taught today. They think that we manage symptoms until it goes away, not let's manage. There's a real disconnect there when people think about the medicines that they're taking. I mean, these are symptom managing medications. Everybody thinks that these medications cure you. Like if you take ibuprofen or aspirin or something like that for a headache, you're managing your symptom with that. You're not curing a headache. What cured that headache was, you know, probably a dose of caffeine that opened up your veins a little bit to allow better blood flow. But what caused that low blood flow? Like these root cause analysis, we don't know. But that's the one thing that medication does, is it's managing of symptoms rather than curing them, right? And so that's what, when I was like on anxiety medication, that's what it did. I knew that if I got the shakes or if I felt a weird little twinge, that I knew was my cue for an anxiety attack coming. Because if you've ever had an anxiety attack, you know exactly what it feels like right before you get it. You'll never forget it. And you'll take a pill, and 27 minutes later, I was cool as a cat, but it was managing the symptom. How did I fix it? I don't know how I fixed it. I just did a lot of meditations, breathing, guided meditations, and it fixed. That was it.
During that time, though, did you find in yourself confronting situations that you were mentally running away from that you were not dealing with?
Yeah. So that's one of the reasons why, if you ever see video casts from my office here on like TMR, you'll see a whiteboard to my left. And that whiteboard I got because I had to write down everything I was doing and every little project that I had to make sure that whether it was a project, something I had to deal with, like I have to make a awkward phone call or, you know, whatever it was, I had to put everything up there to make sure that I would see it every day and cross these things off. I think that was therapeutic in itself as well, was completion of projects, but really attacking internal feelings and stresses. Because when you overload yourself, it's like a car, another analogy, I'm king of analogies, sorry. But if you're going to have an anxiety attack, you know, you're overstressed. Well, it's not like a car where your stress level is like a fuel gauge or a temperature gauge. You don't see it. Your stress level tops out when the oil light comes on. There is no like leading up to it. It's either bing, it's time to change the oil, or the service engine light. There's no like warning that leads up to the service engine light. It's just on. And it's the same way with anxiety attacks related to stress. It's just on. When it happens, it's on. You had no idea, because a lot of times you don't feel stress. And so part of that meditation process and getting rid of the anxiety attacks is confronting those things that cause stress. But if you don't feel that you have any stress, then what are you going to do? So what you got to sit down and do is you do your meditations, you do your guided meditations, and you confront. You have to dig really deep to look for what was stressing you, because you don't know. And then you find an area that maybe it says, you know, you find in yourself this little area of conflict, and you go, oh yeah, that might be a little itch I need to scratch. What is that? And you know, you start turning these stones over. You don't know at the time if that's what it was or not. but by just visually in your mind, imagining like a field of stones with all the names of your problems or even potential problems, and in your mind physically looking at them and flipping those stones over, picking them up and throwing them. As simple as that, just visualizing that took them away. They were gone. So whatever, it's that internal work. It really is. Internal work of your temple, I guess.
Thank you for sharing that again with us. And I'm sure a lot of listeners can relate to those things that are holding us down. And it's interesting to point out that no one really sits back and thinks about why they call it enlightenment. Now, and if you look at the ancient Egyptian Book of the Dead, which a lot of esoteric Masons get to, and there is a degree in the Scottish Rite that goes into it. There's a really important chapter called the Trial of Maat, M-A-apostrophe-A-T. It's called, also known as the Weighing of the Heart Ceremony. Interesting that they believe that every single action that you did was encoded onto your heart, good or bad. And the bad stuff would weigh down your heart, and the good stuff would lighten up your heart. And at the time of your death, you'd pass through all these trials. And the last trial you were faced with is you to go against 42 deities. And they would also weigh your heart against a feather. And depending on how much the heart weighed, you were cast back into this place. Hinduism calls it reincarnation. And everything you've done, unless you made amends with it, is going to be done until you, or unless your heart was lighter than a feather, then you were ascended. You became an ascended master. Like, there's many different translations on what would happen. But I want to point out that the whole process of internal work is freeing up these emotional blockages and freeing up these blockages that we put on ourselves and weigh us down. Right. Especially if you look at posture with people that are holding things onto, it's very clear. This is where you get into all different kinds of modalities of healing. We get into Reiki, acupuncture, massage, trigger point therapy, polarity therapy, Rolfing, all kinds of different exercises that uses different techniques to free up energy flow and blockages to allow you to confront these demons, so to speak, mentally, to move forward. Because a lot of these Eastern philosophical schools of thought and medicines focus on that this negative thought pattern or situation that you're thinking about in the future with anxiety, or the past with depression, literally starts to reside itself into the physical muscle tissue and structure in a nerve column. And they get into how important the 33 spinal column areas are, and how the nerve clusters are actually really connected to the brain, and they actually lodge these memories into the muscle tissue.
Go ahead. So just to interject, you talk about muscle and tissue and everything like that. And what's so fascinating about that was the first time I had like the anxiety attack, the symptom, anxiety causes a physical symptom that isn't real, but it is. Kind of like a gamer's trophy in game. So what you've got is like, I would feel like a weird pulsating sensation in my solar plexus. And then I would get really hot, like I was going to pass out, and I'd get tunnel vision, and then like I'd come out of it for a second. And then I knew the anxiety was coming. And so the first time this happened, I was driving a car, and it happened because a police car whizzed by me with blue and red lights just flashing like crazy. Well, what was funny is every time for a good year and a half after that, this was before I started my meditative work, it was muscle memory. Every time I saw that, it was a cue and my body just went into it. So I could be watching Star Wars, laser blasts, blue and red, or a lightsaber battle, and it was on. Like it started. I had to take a pill. That anxiety does. It goes and it embeds itself into muscle tissue and everything like that. It's so strange. And it was funny because I was explaining it to my doctor. I said, is anxiety related to muscle memory? Can it remember? And he's like, I don't think so. But I mean, it does, because it just happened to me. And the degree, by the way, is the 31st degree. I pulled out my Scottish Rite ritual monitor by our good friend Artie De Hoyos. 31st degree trial of Maat, involving Osiris, Atum, Maat, Thoth, and Anubis. And fascinating degree. And then this book only takes up about 3 or 4 pages, which, it's kind of a bummer, but it's really cool.
It's interesting to note that, you know, the Scottish Rite does a really good job representing each spinal column and how important that lesson is, and things that you could be holding on to in the past or the present, or lessons on moving up and down. Because, right, the spinal column has fluid, it has energy, the whole body has energy, the body has electric pulse, the heart has energy. Each endocrine organ produces actual harmonic, you know, vibrational energy. And you can go up and down this energy, or, you know, focus internally on working on that. And, you know, and Scottish Rite's great for that. But Masonry teaches the bottom half of that. If you get into, let's digress all the way back to King Solomon's Temple, right? So, you know, you have, if you look at King Solomon's Temple, you have like the porch, and then you have the two pillars, and then you have, you know, the base, and then you have the body, you know, you have the whole temple itself, and then you have the altar, and then you have the holies of holies. Now, if we take a step back and we look at that as a human body, you can see shocking correlations of each pillar representing a leg, you know, the porch representing the feet.
Yep.
You know, the third degree usually teaches up to the, you know, the pretty much right to the, you know, the root chakra, and then other degree systems teach past that and how important that is. And there's other different systems with like Hinduism and Buddhism and Sufism and a lot of esoteric sects throughout our society that gets into this esoteric anatomy, or it's been built out through many different temples we can get into later. And you know, there's a lot of correlations.
If you're listening to this on your computer and you want to follow along a little bit, there's a great website called torahtothetribes.com. And if you go there, there's an entry called Temple of Man, Parsha Terumah, or The Offering, by Matthew Moshe Nolan. And it offers some scripture readings there, but also a few diagrams that you'll find interesting. The most common diagram is one that's called the Temple of Man, and it shows a diagram of the temple from a side view. Of course, the altar representing the feet, the pillars representing the legs, the bronze sea actually is omitted from the Temple of Man diagram. However, that could mean, you know, that could be a reproductive area. Then, in addition to that, you have a porch, which is kind of, I would guess, like the groin area. Then there's a holy place, which is waist to the neck, involving several, if you laid the Kabbalistic Tree of Life there, that's, I think, where a good chunk of that resides, along with, as I mentioned earlier, a feeling that I had in my solar plexus, right in the center, kind of underneath your ribs. And initially, that's where I thought I was having a heart attack, because that's where I felt it. But upon later inspection, not so much. And then you have the holy of holies, which is represented as the head, the winding stairs of the staircase, the ramp which relates to Jacob's ladder, or is the throat. And what all that was based upon was supposed to be this Jacob's stone, or the pillow stone, as they call it. And then what's really interesting, and we've talked a little bit about this in the past as well, in a previous episode where Frater O and I talked about the pineal gland and things of that nature. And within that, you have the Holy of Holies, which could represent the pineal gland in itself, the Ark of the Covenant sitting back there as the seat or the throne. Not the idea of the Ten Commandments being held in the Ark, but the Ark as an idea. If you look at the scripture, it'll say that the Ark of the Covenant is more than just a holy vessel to hold these items. It was actually deemed as the seat of God. So when you look at the pineal gland as the seat of God, or a way or a gateway to get there, to these visions or whatever, it could be there, right? And then the other parallel is the fact that there is the sheet that was supposed to cover the Holy of Holies. Now, there's a couple representations that I've seen of it. If you read some texts, it'll say that it was a red cloth with two lions and a serpent on it. Others say that it was a royal purple cloth that covered the back of the Holy of Holies. In the case of the latter, a purple, they say that it could actually represent the membrane in the human body, or in the brain, that when you peel away reveals the pineal gland, just if you were, you know, dissecting a human brain. So very interesting things there as well.
It's also, you know, you're touching on the Ark of the Covenant. If you get into any esoteric Christianity systems, it always talks about the correlation of the Ark of the Covenant pertaining to, you know, that final step of achieving higher states of consciousness, or that threshold, or the seat of the soul. And, you know, each deity, winged deity, angel on the top of it would represent each side of the hemisphere and how important it was to help balance out each side of the hemisphere. We've concluded in Western science and a lot of different Eastern modalities talk about polarity on each side of the body, you know, left and the right side. Positive or negative, male or female, an or ensof, yin or yang, you know, pick your modality. It's the same principle represented over and over and over.
When we talk about that kind of stuff, we look at those modalities and we look at where this is represented. Obviously, people think about the Temple of Man. And we say, well, the Temple of Man, you know, laid out, we've made a little example here of the Solomon's Temple. In addition to this, we've also looked at Luxor's, now that one is literally called the Temple of Man, is it not?
Yeah, that was deemed by us. R.A. Shwaller de Lubicz, who wrote extensively a lot of esoteric information on ancient Egypt, and he wrote two books. One called The Temple in Man and The Temple of Man, and he goes over the whole Luxor Temple and laying out how the Egyptians literally built it completely into stone just in case this information was lost via translations or books were burned. It was literally carved into stone extensively. And there's a really good YouTube series you can watch for free online, which is called Magical Egypt, which is done by John Anthony West. And if those people who are not familiar with John Anthony West, he's currently still alive. He's an Egyptologist. He does amazing tours in Egypt. He wrote a really good book called The Serpent in the Sky, and he bases all his life research on R.A. Shwaller de Lubicz, the curator of the London Museum in the 1800s, and breaks down the seat of the soul and topics that we're talking about, and really focuses a lot of his research on the Luxor Temple. And the Magical Egypt series, it's 5 parts, each is an hour long, so you don't have to get burnt out by watching 5 hours straight, and it gets into the temple and higher states of consciousness and initiatic ceremonies and how important achieving your life's work or your life's purpose and those deep philosophical principles. And that's great. And those who aren't familiar with it, we'll put some links up to the YouTube series or to also some diagrams. But those two books that Shwaller wrote, they're great. The Temple of Man and the Temple in Man. Wonderful reads.
Sweet. Yeah, definitely. We'll put some links up to that. And that was going to be a question of mine, whether or not they were digestible. So 5 chunks of an hour each is not too bad, I guess. Depends on how serious you are. I'm sure we'll have some listeners who decide it. Instead of a Netflix binging watch over the weekend, it's going to be those. I know I'd do that if I didn't have to turn on SpongeBob SquarePants for the kids.
There's an interesting quote by Thomas Jefferson. It's and the quote goes along the lines of, "I'm going to build the secrets into the geometry of these buildings because I know books can be burnt and buildings cannot be burnt so easily." And that's a really interesting quote because we keep seeing the same system from ancient Egypt. You can go into ancient Aztec or Mayans and find similar temples to even ancient Hinduism or Eastern Buddhist temples or Hinduism temples that they have similar layouts of the human body. But in interesting note with masonry in King Solomon's temple, yet there's also another correlation predating Freemasonry with the Knights Templars and the Gothic cathedrals, which happen to be the building guilds of called the Sons of Solomon by the Knights Templar.
Ah, very interesting. So are we tying that into something like Roslyn's Chapel then and other things like
absolutely,
that?
Absolutely, Roslyn's Chapel. But if you look at all 400 plus Gothic cathedrals built by the Knights Templar, you'll see a lot of shocking correlations of a human body being built into the physical temple itself.
Very interesting. I have seen some things related to that in which, specifically speaking, Roslyn's Temple, I've seen diagrams and I've seen videos explaining some of the pillars within the temple there where they feel that the design of the pillar is such that it explains it's a DNA double helix, some things like that. So what's interesting about that is this idea of, I guess, quote unquote, high science being demonstrated in an age where these people should not have known about DNA or anything like that. But aside from the high sciences being displayed, there are a number of motifs and the actual layout and the geometrical layout, rather, and the ratios that we use when we look at the human body, are employed in the construction of these temples.
So if you look at the, you know, the double helix, the golden ratio is built extensively everywhere throughout, you know, the Gothic cathedrals. And if you look at the human body and chakras, and you look at, you know, different parts of the human body, pointing to the glandular systems or the chakras, you can find shocking correlations between all the Gothic cathedrals and all the temples we've mentioned before. And it's consistently hidden directly in plain sight. Even if you look at, you know, the Kabbalah and, you know, the actual what it is, the atom. If you lay down on the floor and you look at a lot of the Gothic cathedrals, that is directly pretty much built into the cross member beams throughout a majority of the temples.
Yeah, it was pretty interesting. We actually sat down and we went on Google Maps and we took images of the Kabbalah Tree of Life, and we took images of the body of man, a few different versions of it, and we grabbed screenshots of these different cathedrals mentioned in a certain book that Frater O had read a little while back. And so there was a French author, he wrote this book. We took these images and I went into Photoshop and I started superimposing the Kabbalistic Tree of Life and the body of man, or Adam Kedmon, however you want to pronounce it. And we started laying it over these temples and absolutely, totally aligned. We even did one in Washington, D.C., and the body of man fits right, you know, you just turn the map and it like locks into place, really. All I can say is if you have the ability, some old Photoshop, maybe Photoshop 7 or something like that, it's very inexpensive if you ever, or I don't even think you can buy it. You probably just have to download it from oldversions.com or something. But if you grab a couple screenshots and you can play around with the opacity of the top layer and you kind of just spin it around until it fits, and you'll see that these layouts are everywhere. And going back to that quote by Jefferson, where he says that he's building these things in stone or in buildings because books can be easily burnt, this is perhaps where that comes from. This is why we're doing it. This is why they did it, was because there is some truth that they've preserved. And when the human mind hits a point where we can understand it on a whole and a national and a society level or on a global level, when we're ready to see it, maybe that's the gatekeeper. Maybe when we're ready to see it, that is the prerequisite for being able to understand it. And so you look at those things and you have to kind of, I almost had a David Childress moment. You have to ask yourself, you look at the way these things are laid out. It's just fascinating. You know, we're kind of on the path. We think we're on that path to understanding what it is, but are we? And if we had all the resources in the world, if we could just drop everything we were doing and dive 100% into this, what could we discover? I don't know.
There's a really good YouTube series we mentioned too in the past called Secrets in Plain Sight by a Berkeley architecture professor, and Scott Onslaught or Onset, I'm not sure the pronunciation of his last name, and he has a YouTube series. It's fairly long. The first Secret in Plain Sight, if you want to buy the second series, you have to buy a DVD on his website. And he also came out with a book, but he talks about the same symbology represented consistently throughout the world, and he uses Google Maps to explain all these ancient sites, and it's really well done, really well documented. The gentleman did his research. He's not a Mason, but he's into the esoterics, and he does the shocking correlations on not taking these ancient maps, but taking the Leonardo da Vinci's man. What's the man called? I'm drawing a blind.
The Vitruvian?
I think it is the Vitruvian man.
Let's see.
But anyways, he takes his man and overlays it over DC, overlays it over Paris, and shocking correlations. And you can take these occult anatomy maps and put it over his. We've done and put it over his map. So again, this symbolism has been hidden throughout history consistently over and over and over. For the initiate, when he wakes up, he can start to see it. And if he's really drawn to this, the secrets are literally hidden in plain sight. But until he starts doing the inner work, he can't do it. No book, no pen, no class. No one else can do it for you. There's absolutely, you have to do it yourself, and you have to do the internal work.
I totally agree.
So with any Masonic teaching, you know, we learn it a certain way. However, every Mason now listening to this podcast is going back to Lodge, and you're sitting there, just take a step back, and instead of just be a part of it, just take a step back and ask yourself, when you walk in before Lodges, okay, if this is the human body that I'm learning, or this is the hidden body, and this is my psyche, and this is the subconscious, what am I not learning? What am I going to learn? And going with that mindset versus I'm just going to come here and hear old people complain about their problems. different aspects and look at it that way. And we'll put a bunch of links that we talked about in the show notes.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Do you have anything else, any books that helped you or things that you can point towards?
Specifically looking at if you ever pick up, I don't have books per se that I could recommend, but if you head down to your local bookstore, your Barnes and Nobles or whatever, you go over into the religious sections or whatever, or do a web search for beginner Kabbalah or basics, or use simple search terms, and there's nothing wrong with reading a Cliff Notes version of some epic tome that's going to explain something, because you're going to get something out of it and you'll start to form a foundation for the rest of the knowledge, and then you can dig deeper and you can pick up heftier tomes on these things. And don't be scared of the big language, and that's why I say, like, go grab a Cliff Notes version of something off the start, because that will build a small foundation. There was a great book that Frater O recommended to me about the chakras. I didn't know where to start, and he recommended this old paperback, and it's literally a half inch thick, and it's such a great book, and it formed a great basis for me to go on and search even more. So if there's things that you want to research, definitely check out, you know, a small Cliff Notes version type thing, and let that be your guide into diving even deeper. But as Frater O said, digressing back to when you walk into a lodge. As a master of my lodge this year, there is something that I'm able to do, which is invite new candidates up to the East to watch either a stated meeting or a degree from the East, because it's a different experience. And what I tell them when they get up there is, I want you to watch everything we're doing up here. Watch the synchronicity that's happening. And as any truth can't be really conveyed, it has to be revealed to yourself by yourself, I guess. So think about, as you're watching the lodge opening, closing, think about how this correlates to some facet of your mind or the planets or the temple or, you know, whatever it might be. Relate it on a deeper level than just these guys are walking around. And you're going to see, well, if you're somebody who hasn't done this, you're going to come up with some really interesting correlations. Brother Greg Kaminsky, last time we talked with Frater O on this subject, in our closing statements, had something very similar to say. And it was to kind of think about this thing, the lodge opening and closing, as a series of compartmentalized events that happen within your mind. Are you preparing a mind to make a decision? Are you preparing your mind for something else? And I know it sounds very cryptic and it's not meant to be, but again, as with any, a lot of the things in these topics, words don't suffice. But we will, of course, post links to Magical Egypt and Secrets in Plain Sight, as well as a few versions of some of these maps. And I will also put up the link to the page I mentioned earlier, that if you were following along. And we were correct, Frater O. It is the Vitruvian Man, for sure.
Oh, thank you. You know, and to go off your point, what you mentioned is, you know, King Solomon's temple had thousands of workmen. And if you think about your body, you have millions of workmen inside yourself. Going back to what you talked about, pay attention to what it teaches you on how to set the craft from refreshment to labor.
So I'll throw this on everybody's lap too, is something to think about. I'm not putting like a question out there that I know the answer to. This is just me being curious. And shoot us an email if you figure something out, or if you put it together. But King Solomon's temple, looking at the measurements laid out in some of the holy books, says that the actual temple, the temple itself, not the courts, not the outer courts, the temple is so small it would fit in a basketball court. Previous versions of the temple were a tabernacle set up in the desert, and every night the temple would be set up in the desert, and three tribes on each side, so far, so many cubits away from the temple, and they would camp this way to surround it. Every day they would wake up and they would break the temple down, and each tribe was assigned to hold on to some portion of it, whether it was the columns or the wrappings or whatever it was going to be. And so the temple, when it was built by Solomon, it wasn't, you know, the temple itself, like I said, would fit in a basketball court, but we have these depictions of it that are so huge and just massive, and that encompasses, of course, the courts. And then at one point, there's some diagrams that show that there is a tower in the temple that goes up as far as 20 stories tall. Now, if you are a Mason listening to this and you're a master mason, look in your ritual book. And in one of the lectures, I believe in the third degree, it pulls some scripture. And the scripture tells how many workmen, breaking it down into everything. So it tells you how many workmen were there, how many columns, how many pilasters. And it also tells you that, now we're not giving anything away because this is all just, you can read it all in your St. James Bible. It talks about that there was no sound at the building of King Solomon's temple. So my question for everybody out there, I guess, would be, why so many workers? Up to, I think there was 70,000 fellow crafts and 3 grandmasters. Did it take that many people to create such a small building? Or now, if you take this quite literally and somebody's going to say, oh, you're an idiot, the answer is just because they're talking about all of it. The courts, the temple, the tower, everything. Okay, I buy that. But just a small building, I don't know if it would take that. I don't know anything about that kind of thing. I don't know about ancient building. But think about, would it really require that many builders to build a building? So you have, does it actually take 150,000 3 people to build a small building? So the other question is, if it was built without any noise, is that an allusion to you as a person making inner building without making noise? And lastly, if it doesn't reflect to that, does it refer to the notion that Solomon built his temple using his signet ring and controlling demons? Now, what does that mean? If he's controlling demons to build a temple, is that circumscribing your passions and controlling yourself? Your demons? I mean, what are they making an allusion to there? Maybe. I don't know. I'm not claiming to have any answers. I'm just throwing these things out there for contemplation, I guess. So that's all I have.
You know, if there's any areas of the topics that we've mentioned on and you'd like to hear more or have questions, just reach out. You know, in future episodes, we can bring it up and talk about it or set up a correspondence.
I think that would be a fantastic idea. So again, if you guys have any questions, if you guys want us to talk on a specific subject, definitely email us and say, hey, I want to hear more about this. I want to hear more about that. Or have you guys read this book? Can you talk about this book? Whatever it is, give us some topics to talk about, because we can talk about just, we can talk on anything. If you're an author of an interesting esoteric book or anything like that, shoot us an email, some excerpts from it, and we can talk, the three of us. I think we'll have a good time. So with that, I just say, Frater O, thanks again for joining us on the program.
Thank you again for having me, and I look forward to future discussions.
Indeed. All right, again, thanks so much to Frater O for hopping on the program and spending some time with us. We will have, of course, as we mentioned, all of the links to many of those things, Magical Egypt, Secrets in Plain Sight, and even that cool website that explained the Temple of Man a little bit. We will also show those books. Frater O was kind enough to email me all of the links right after the interview, and we have those available right there in the show notes, so please do check those out. And now we'll go right into illustrious brother Stephen L. Harrison's Masonic Minute.
I'm forever blowing bubbles, pretty bubbles in the air. They fly so high, nearly reach the sky. Then, like my dreams, they fade and die. You've no doubt heard that frivolous ditty written in 1918, but did you know without it one of Masonry's greatest institutions might not exist? Forrest Adair, past potentate of Yarab Temple in Atlanta, was an attendee at the June 1920 Imperial Session in Portland, Oregon, which was considering the establishment of a shrine hospital for children. Delegates had suggested funding the hospital with a $2 assessment to each member, but support for the project was unenthusiastic. Brother Adair was somewhat resigned to the fact that the delegates would scrub the proposal. Early on the morning of the vote, however, a minstrel, possibly inebriated, stood beneath his hotel room playing "I'm Forever Blowing Bubbles" on his horn. The song, about wasting time with frivolity, woke Adair, and its meaning stuck with him. He related it to the activities of the shrine, which, although it had its various charities at the time, was more about having fun. That afternoon at the session, as the delegates wrangled and the idea of a hospital seemed lost, Brother Adair rose and spoke passionately about the experience early that morning. "I am reminded," he said, "of that wandering minstrel, and I wonder if there is not a deep significance for the Shriners in the tune he was playing, I'm Forever Blowing Bubbles. While we have spent money for songs and spent money for bands, it's time for the Shrine to spend money for humanity. I want to see this thing started. Let's get rid of all the technical objections, and if there is a Shriner in North America who objects to having paid the $2 after he has seen the first disabled child helped, I will give him a check back for it myself." After Adair's speech, not only did the resolution pass unanimously, but it also spawned a committee whose research indicated the Shrine should build not one, but a nationwide network of hospitals. Today, the Shriners' Hospitals for Children are known worldwide. The network, called the World's Greatest Philanthropy, consists of 22 medical facilities located in North America. It treats children with a variety of conditions, including burns and spinal cord injuries. The hospitals care for children in a family-friendly environment and offer their services regardless of the patient's ability to pay, requiring no affiliation to Freemasonry. Unlike the bubbles in the song, this is one dream that did not fade and die. For the Whence Came You podcast, this is Steve Harrison with the Masonic Minute.
All right, always awesome time for the Masonic Minute. If you enjoyed that, you can go to the next level. If you subscribe to the WCY podcast channel on YouTube, there's a video for it. So it is accompanied with pictures relevant to the story, and Brother Stephen L. Harrison puts those together for us. So he not only records these segments for us, but he also puts together these videos, and they are on his channel as well as mine. So we put those out there for you guys, and I really hope you enjoy them. I know that I do, and please support Brother Stephen L. Harrison's works by going to Amazon.com and picking up a copy of Tales from the Craft or Freemasons at Oak Island, which I love Freemasons Tales from the Craft, but Freemasons at Oak Island really hits a chord with me because I'm very into the treasure hunt, as you may have figured out with my obsession with things like, you know, ancient mysteries, treasures, and, you know, even this latest Masonic Radio Theater. So check that out. Please go ahead and pick up a copy of that book. We'll have links to that as well in the show notes. It's always a pleasure. All right, next we're going to go right into this week's famous Freemason. So this week's famous Freemason might ring a bell from Masonic ritual, actually. Sir Walter Scott. Now, if you do a certain Bible presentation ceremony, you may recognize the name, and that is from the end of that lecture. But what's interesting here is that Walter Scott was actually, I should mention that he's a Scottish novelist, playwright, and poet, and he was actually initiated, passed, and raised at an emergency meeting of St. David's Lodge number 36 in Edinburgh on the 2nd of March in 1801. So I'm curious as to why there was such a emergency, but perhaps when we look into his biography a little bit, we'll figure it out. Born the 15th of August, 1771, and he passed away the 21st of September in 1832, and he was a Scottish historical novelist, playwright, and poet with many contemporary readers in Europe, Australia, and North America. Scott's novels and poetry are still read, and many of his works remain classics of both English language literature and of Scottish literature. Famous titles include Ivanhoe, Rob Roy, Old Morality, The Lady of the Lake, Waverley, The Heart of Midlothian, and The Bride of Lammermoor. Although primarily remembered for his extensive literary works and his political engagement, Scott was an advocate, judge, and legal administrator by profession, and throughout his career combined his writing and editing work with his daily occupation as a clerk of session and sheriff deputy of Selkirkshire. A prominent member of the Tory establishment in Edinburgh, Scott was an active member of the Highland Society and served a long term as president of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, 1820 to 1832. Scott's father, also Walter, born 1729, passed away 1799, was a Freemason, being a member of the Lodge of St. David, number 36 in Edinburgh, and Scott also became a Freemason in his father's lodge in 1801, albeit only after the death of his father. Scott actually went through quite a bit of financial problems in his life due to an 1825 wide banking crisis in the United Kingdom, which resulted in the collapse of the Ballantine printing business, of which Scott was the only partner with a financial interest. His wife, Lady Scott, had died in 1826. Scott died owing money in his later years, but his novels continued to sell, and the debts encumbering his estate were discharged shortly after his death. That's it for this week. Please find us on Facebook and check us out on Twitter at WhenceKMU. You can email us at the email address admin@wcypodcast.com or at wcypodcast@gmail.com. Either one of those will come straight to me, and I hope you don't forget to read The Midnight Freemasons 3 times a week. Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. We've got excellent content always going up there. It's all for free. If you are a writer, a Masonic yourself, and you'd like to submit an article, go ahead and shoot me the article along with a picture and a brief bio. We'll take a look at it and make sure that it's all good to go, and we can edit your paper if you need a little bit of editing. That's fine, too. As always, the Masonic Roundtable goes live every Tuesday at 10, 9 central. This week, we're going to talk about balance. So the work-life balance you might have. You might have a lodge-life balance, like I do. So, you know, it'll be a good episode for you guys who are young in masonry and are struggling with how to make this all work. A lot of us are family men. We have families. And as a millennial generation, we value our family time a lot more than previous generations, where previous generations would spend more time at work. You know, our generation looks more like, hey, I want to spend more time with my kids. That time with family is more important for whatever reason to our generation. So how do we balance that? And I think this will be a great episode to talk about some of those things. You can interact with us on Twitter, so please do ask some questions, make some comments and suggestions, because we'll read them on the show live for everybody else to check out. And it's a great way to contribute to the conversation. So with that, also just want to say quick congratulations to John Ruark, past master, who is now going to be king of his Royal Arch chapter. I never congratulate Nick Johnson on the program because he's always got some amazing title. So if you're listening, Nick, congrats on, I mean, next week you're going to be Grand Master of Minnesota probably. So, but anyway, I hope you guys all have a great week. And until next time, stay on the level. For Whence KMU, I'm Robert Johnson.